And in India, he was speared to death. But yet, one moment of indecision in his life, one moment of doubt, and now he has been labeled and branded a doubter. I have come by way of the Link Church today to ask you a question. What defines you? What defines you? Every time you wake up in the morning and you look in the mirror, what do you allow to define who you are? What do you allow to define what others say about you? What do you allow in your life to define what even you say about you? I have to tell you that I am 40 years old, and used to, I would get up in the morning and I would look in the mirror and I would say, "Behold, you look so good. You're so wonderful." But now, being 46, now I have Dunlap disease, and my belly's Dunlapped over my belt, and my back goes out more than my wife and I. And so I was in a store the other day, and somebody had asked me, "How long you been married?" And I said, "This coming February, it's going to be 20 years, and I began to think about that for a moment. I can't believe I found a woman who would put up with me for 20 years, much less having been married for 20 years. Some of you, after church is over, need to go up to Stephanie and hug her neck and say, "God bless your heart, honey." What do I allow to define who I am? If you allow your physique to define who you are, I promise eventually your physique isn't going to be there. Wait a minute. The physique will be there. It'll just be one big blob. Where there used to be abs, now there's fat. Where there used to be where you used to be able to go out in a field and look across the field and see everything that was coming for miles around, now you've got to put your spectacles on. I've got to tell you, this morning I woke up and I was reading over the passage of Scripture, and Stephanie was in the bathroom and she was getting ready, and she heard me say from the bed, she heard me say, "Oh!" And she said, "What's wrong with you?" I said, "I'm trying to look on this stupid phone and find out what passage of Scripture I'm using because I don't remember, but I can't see it." Or you laugh. It means you're not there yet. But I'm telling you, I was in bed this morning and I could not even see. And so she brought me my glasses and I put my glasses on. And I was like, "Oh, I can see. And I could read just fine." If we are waiting on something outside of ourselves to define us, what is outside of ourselves shall always change. The sum of a man is not determined by things or houses or physique, but the sum of a man is determined by a life well lived, life lessons learned, and life lessons taught. May I tell you that as you learn the life lessons over your life, over the course of your life, you shall be defined by that which you have done. Nobody shouts on that one. Because I know why. You're thinking in your mind, "Well, my goodness, I was defined by this and I was defined by that." People shall always define you based upon what it is you've done. The sum of an individual is not determined by houses, cars, things, or even your physique. But the sum of an individual is determined by the way you live your life. And may I tell you, even by the mistakes that you've made along the way. But I am here today to tell you that Jesus rose from the dead so that the mistakes that have been made in our yesterday does not have to define who we are today. People will always call you. Here we are 2,000 years later, and people are always talking about Thomas and how he doubted, and yet it was Thomas who gave his life on a foreign field so that the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ could be touted and told, and so that people could come to know the Lord Jesus as their Savior. Peter. You know Peter. Peter had denied the Lord three times prior to the crucifixion, and now he's sitting in this room, and Jesus is now resurrected from the dead, and the women come to the tomb, and Jesus said, I want you to go tell the disciples and Peter that he's risen. What's the point? The point is that Jesus, although Peter had been defined by his failure, although Peter had been defined as he looked in the mirror, I am a failure. Can you imagine what happened on the first supper after Jesus had resurrected from the dead and now the disciples are all sitting there? John the Revelator is the only one who stayed with Jesus till the end. John is the only one that we find was at the cross. John was the only one standing there with the mother of Jesus. John was the only one. The Bible says that John is the one who Jesus really loved, and it was John who was the only one who stood there. We know that he wrote the book of Revelation. We know that he was boiled in oil and put on the Isle of Patmos. But what else can we say that John has done? Peter, however, and we'll be finding out about this in about, 40 days or so. Peter was the one who stood on the day of Pentecost, and it was Peter who was the spokesman for the group, and it was Peter who preached to the multitudes. Although Peter had failed him, Peter decided that he would not allow his failure to define who he was in himself, that God had a purpose for his life and God had a reason for him to be. In fact, it was Jesus sitting around a campfire with his disciples, says to Peter, three times, do you love me? And all three times Peter says, I love you. Why in the world did Jesus have to ask him three times? In fact, the Bible is very specific and says that when he asked Peter, do you love me? And Peter said, Lord, you know I love you. Jesus asks him again the second time, Peter, do you love me? Well, Lord, you know I love you. And when he asked him the third time, Lord, why do you keep asking me this? I've already answered the question. Peter had denied him three times, and three times he had to reaffirm that he is the Lord, the King of glory, and that he would follow him, even if it meant following him to his death. Peter, do you love me? Tradition tells us that Peter was forced to watch his children and his wife executed, crucified, and then when it came his turn, he decided that he was going to be crucified upside down because he was not worthy to be crucified as the Lord. Peter, obviously, even though his failure screamed at him, you've denied the Lord Jesus. I wonder what it must have been like that first meal that they had together as they looked at Peter and as they looked at Thomas and as they looked at the others who had ran away and said, man, you're a bunch of hypocrites. I wonder if you ever look in the mirror and you think, man, what a hypocrite. You're not all that in a bag of chips. You're not as big and as bad and as holy as you want people to think. And may I tell you that if we give ear to those around us, they may be telling us the exact same thing. Who do you think that you are? Who do you believe yourself to be? My question to you today is, what have you allowed to define your life? Maybe you've allowed drugs and alcohol to define who you are. Now you wake up in the morning, and although you've come to the altar and although the blood of Jesus has been applied to your life, you saw somebody at the store last week who said, oh, that's old addict so-and-so. Hey, there's the man that used to be mean. There's the man who hurt me. There's the one who couldn't do anything right. What is it that defines who you are? And although I believe the disciples did some wonderful things after the resurrection of Jesus, I find it interesting that really the only ones that we've ever been given great specificity to and of are the ones who always failed Jesus. Please don't let that be lost on you today. Because we allow religion to define who we are. Religion says you're not good enough. You're not holy enough. You're not righteous enough. You haven't done enough genuflecting to get the job done. You haven't prayed the rosary long enough. You haven't confessed enough. You haven't done enough. And if you ever want to be worthy of Jesus, you're going to somehow have to do enough. And if you don't do enough, then you cannot be worthy in the sight of God. Thus, people are waking up every single morning looking in the mirror, trying to get to a holy and righteous God and saying, I'm not good enough, and I'm not holy enough, and I'm not righteous enough. What defines you? Yet the word says that we are the righteousness of God in Christ. The word says, my little children, these things I write unto you, do not sin. And if you do sin, we have an advocate with the Father. That if we will confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And yet we run to the altar and we beg and we snot and we cry and we say, oh my God, I have failed, I have failed, I have failed. Your failure does not mean that you must quit. Your failure means that you must pick yourself up and keep moving on, because God has a work for you to do and a plan for your life, and all it's going to take is for you not to allow your past to define you. Our past will define us. Number one. Number two, our parents will define us. I am so lucky and I'm so blessed. My mom and daddy were not perfect. I have to tell you, I have never met anyone that's perfect. I know a lot of people who claim to be perfect. Most of them go to church, but I deal with them on a daily basis. They're not perfect either. I'm not perfect. You're not perfect. None of us are perfect. My parents were not perfect, but I was talking to my daddy the other day, and he was kind of lamenting the things that he had allowed me to see from him in my life. We have a joke at my house, and the joke is to my kids, if you don't knock it off, you're about to see a George Airy. My dad was masterful at taking and 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 taking. And then all of a sudden you would let a little feather fall on the pile and it was, some of you are laughing because you're the same way. Some of you are laughing because you pull George Airy's at your house all the time. My daddy was not perfect, but I was talking to him, and he was lamenting over the things in his life. He's now getting close to 80, and he was talking to me, and he was lamenting over the things that he had allowed me to see in my lifetime. And I said to him, I stopped him, and I said, Daddy, I got to let you know, not one time in all of my history did I ever feel as if you did not love me. And so now my dad here is almost 80 years old. I am 40-something years old. I got more gray hair than what I used to have. My eyes don't work like they used to. I had gone through the entirety of my life thinking how much my dad loved me. And what I did not know was my dad was sitting in a corner, wringing his hands, lamenting over what he allowed to define himself and what he allowed to define his relationship with me. My daddy is my hero. My daddy is a good man. My daddy did a lot of things good for my life. My daddy laid and placed in my life a firm foundation. Although he was not perfect, my daddy laid a firm foundation, and I am standing in here today as a direct result of the fact that my daddy was a good man. My My daddy taught me a work ethic. I would watch my daddy get up in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning, and he would go to work every single day. Oh, he might come home wringing his hands and going, man, I can't wait till I retire. Sometimes he would wake up in the morning and we would be getting ready to go to school and he would be going, oh, I don't want to go to work today. But I watched my daddy go to work every single day. I watched him go to work when he felt like it, and I watched him go to work when he didn't feel like it. And my daddy, some of you think I'm a jack wagon because I'm like, you got to come to church, you got to come to church. Man, I just tired today. Why is pastor like that? Because of my daddy. Don't blame me, blame my daddy. Because I watched my daddy go to work when he didn't feel like it. Complete his life's work the whole time wanting to retire. And yet he still got up every single morning and he went to work. I watched my daddy get up and go to work every single morning when a pink slip, well, you know what I'm talking about, those layoff notices, was hanging over his head. He did not say, well, I'm going to get laid off anyway, I just might as well not go. My daddy, only one time, as all of his friends were getting laid off from Rockwell International, my daddy got one slip of paper one time. He had packed up all of his tools. He had made it out to his car, and somebody came running out to him and said, George, can you do any carpentry? And my dad said, yes. And the man said, well, I've got a carpenter's position for you. And he finished out his work there at Rockwell International within the carpentry department. Everybody knew that my daddy was a workhorse. On Saturday mornings, boy, I hated it. While all my friends were sleeping. We had moved to Skytook, Oklahoma when I was 13 years old, and we lived in the boondocks. They had to build a road to get to my mom and daddy's house. And right where their house is sitting, my daddy cut down 27 trees. And not only did he have to cut them down, but then he had to get the stumps out. And every morning while my friends were watching Saturday morning cartoons, my daddy would come in my room and he would say, time to get up. What time is it, daddy? It's 6 o'clock. What? And I would have to get up with my daddy, and me and my sister would go out in the woods and we would cut down trees so that we could be warm in the wintertime, because the only heat we had at that time was a wood-burning stove that would run you out of there, if you would run you out of the living room, and you would freeze in the bedrooms. They still have that wood-burning stove, and I have to tell you, there are a lot of memories around that wood-burning stove, and a lot of them aren't very good. Because I knew to feed that wood-burning stove, I had to go out and help my daddy cut wood. And we would spend, I remember one time we went to the lake one summer because my daddy had this idea that all work and no play kind of made you a dull person. And so we would go play hard. And one summer afternoon, my dad had taken off a week from work and borrowed a boat and took us out to the lake, and we went water skiing. That was so cool. But how many of you know what happens when you go to the lake for the first time and you've been wearing jeans all year round and now all of a sudden you put on a pair of shorts? You get sunburnt. And I was sunburnt. I was sunburnt from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet. I was hurting. We spent all day at the lake. My grandparents, Tommy and Marie Roberts, came and brought us a bunch of corn by the bushels. And my dad, I remember it well. My dad says, oh, looky there. Your grandparents brought us a bunch of corn. I said, well, that's nice. What's all that stuff they got around it? Some of you young people won't get that. But notice, look around, all the old people are laughing because they know what I'm talking about. And so here I was, sunburnt from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet, and my dad, as I'm walking in the house, says, "Where are you going?" I said, "Well, Dad, I'm tired. I got lake water on me. I'm going to go take a shower." And Dad says, "Oh, don't waste your time doing that. There's always time for shower later. We got corn to shuck." What? "Dad, I'm tired." It didn't matter if I was tired. We got out there, and my mama, Kim, find it if you can. My mama has a picture of me sitting there shucking corn, and my younger sister is next to me, and we got this look on our face like, I'm about to kill somebody. Got my hat turned around backwards, and I am not happy because we sitting there shucking corn. And it wasn't just that you had to shuck it. You had to take a knife and get all the dead stuff off of it. And then they had this big barrel, and we'd throw it in that. But I want you to know it. I'll just tell you how old I am. At 46 years old, that experience has defined me. But some people were not as lucky as I was. And your parents made all kinds of mistakes, and they said all kinds of things to you. You know what I'm talking about, like you're never going to amount to anything. You know what I'm talking about. I have a friend that in our growing up years, I hated his daddy. Because every time I'd go over to his house, he'd say, "What are you, stupid?" You tell a child long enough that they're stupid, and that's going to become a prophecy in their life, and they're going to become stupid, because what you say to a child is what they will become. "What are you, a loser? Get your head screwed on straight, boy." I never had to hear those things from my daddy or from my mama. But I have to tell you, there were many nights that I would hear my mama shedding tears over me because I wasn't doing the right thing. I would spend the night at my grandparents' house, and I don't know why eggs tasted better at my grandma's than they did my house, but eggs tasted better at my grandmother's house. And they had a couch, and you could pull it out and make a bed. And I always liked to sleep on that. And now if I ever go to anybody's house and they pull out that couch for me, I'm like, "Oh, Lord." Because when I was 8, I could sleep on it and my back not hurt. Now that I'm 46, now I got to roll out of bed because my back's hurt. Because there's a bar right in the middle. When I was 8, it wasn't that big of a deal, but now it's a big deal. But I would go spend the night at my grandmother's house. And she had her own room, and she would go in her room, and there, when she thought everybody was asleep, I would hear her calling the names of her grandchildren, one after the other, praying for us that God would have his hand on our life. Ladies and gentlemen, you cannot go through times and seasons like that and not have it define who you are. Parents will define who you are. Number 3, peers will define. My mama always had a saying, and it drove me nuts every time she said it. "Birds of a feather flock together." I don't think I can say this strong enough. Every time my mama said, birds of a feather flock together, you know what I would think? Yeah, here you are trying to control me. Birds of a feather, Greg, flock together. She had told me what she thought of my friends, so when she told me birds of a feather flock together, she was saying, because you're flocking with those birds, you're the same. I'd get so mad. The reason I would get so mad is because she was right. Birds of a feather flock together. Eagles do not soar with turkeys. And turkeys do not soar with eagles. You cannot be running around with a bunch of turkeys and soar like the eagle that God has created you to be. Because the human race is so funny. Now, if an eagle gets with a turkey, anybody know what the eagle's going to do to the turkey? He's going to kill it and eat it. Because even a turkey knows, or even an eagle knows, that turkey's some good eating. But he's not going to run around with it for very long. Because he knows that the turkey has been given for him to lord over, for him to be better than, not to run around with. And as I watch God's people, a bunch of eagles, who God has created you to soar in the heavens and have dominion over the turkeys, as you run around with them, the human race is the only race, because not even eagles will start gobbling like turkeys. But the human race, when running around with turkeys, will start gobbling just like the turkey. If you don't believe me, you can go to some of my friends who will go out at 4 in the morning and sit in the woods and go, come on, why? Because they're looking for turkeys. They're trying to draw the turkeys in. The human race is the only race that I know. A dog does not look at a puppy and start babying it. A human, however, will get around a bunch of babies and we become morons. Oh, goo goo gaga. Oh, goo doo 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 doo. Oh, you're so cute. Oh, doo 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 doo. We get around puppies and we start behaving like puppies. If you don't believe me, you come to my house on a daily basis. We got a dog. His name is Santos. Santos is a good dog. But when I walk in the door and his tail's, man, he giving it this. He giving, oh, daddy's home, daddy's home, daddy's home. Oh, hello, hello, doggy, good doggy. And then we start doing this, and watch him as he does the same thing. You better listen, because you get around your friends who are doing drugs. What if you can't get around a puppy without babying him, or get around a baby without babying it, and changing the way you talk and changing the way you walk? How do you think that you can get around a druggie and not use? Birds of a feather flock together. And the human race is this race that desires to just fit in. If we're with a dog, we want, this is stupid. This is how stupid I am. I'm not even going to talk about you. I'm going to talk about me. This is how stupid I am, that when I get around my dog, I want my dog to identify with me and to feel like he's part of the pack. And so in order for him to feel like he's part of the pack, I got to go, roar. My neighbors must think I'm a moron. Santos can be outside. He's an American pit. He can be outside. saying, Santos, Santos. And there's no Santos. And you're thinking, did he get out of the yard? Did he do that? But all you got to do is go, and here comes Santos just running. So can you picture me standing in my underwear out the back door? 3 o'clock in the morning. Some of you are laughing because you just pictured it. And that's so wrong. I didn't tell you to. I just said, can you? So if we're going to want dogs to identify with us and cats to identify with us, what makes you think you're going to, oh, and I mean this with all the love in my heart, but what makes you think you're not going to be able to get around a loser and not become one? Now, Pastor, I don't think you ought to call people losers. I don't think that you ought to call... The Apostle Paul said in talking about the works of the flesh which are manifest, which are these, he gets to the end and he says, and such were some of you. There is none good, no, not one. I remember this is this month, and I hope you don't mind me telling this. If you do, it'll be over here in just a minute, so don't worry about it. This is the second anniversary of Abby's death. In about 2 days. And I got to tell you that these talks Abby and I had. Abby, you, honey, are better than the drug addict. And she'd always say to me, I'm not better than anybody. And I'd say, Abby, to me you are. Isn't it funny that the things that drove us nuts about our parents, we grow up and now we have kids of our own, and now we start saying the same thing that drove us nuts? And I would always tell Abby, Abby, birds of a feather flock together. And then I'd be like, oh God, you're your mother. Abby, birds of a feather flock together. Abby, if you don't get away from the turkeys are going to cost you. When you're trying to be one lone eagle in a pack of turkeys, if they run in packs, chances are you're not going to be able to stay an eagle very long, and you're going to start acting like a turkey. So our past defines us. Our parents defines us. And our peers will define us. What we need to allow to define us is the presence. The presence, not the presence of the pastor, not the presence of grandma, not the presence of grandpa, because one of these days, if they have not already, your grandparents are going to die. And I figured out a long time ago that I'm not going to be able to get to heaven based upon what my grandparents did, but I'm going to have my own personal relationship with a holy God and be reconciled to Him. In the same way my grandparents were reconciled to Him. Were my grandparents perfect? Oh, absolutely not. But I've got to tell you, they were good people who allowed God to work in their life despite their past, despite their failures, despite anything that may have happened prior. And they allowed the blood of Jesus to wash them and cleanse them from all of their past, from all of their sin. And they did not allow the past to define who they are. They did not allow the past to keep my grandfather from starting churches. No matter what anybody said about him, he was a church builder. No matter what anybody could say, ever say about my grandmother, she was a good woman. Now, she used to carry this hanky. And my grandmother, you didn't want to sit in front of her during church. Because if everything was just right, she'd do something like this. And by the way, this was a Baptist church. So praise and worship is a little more quiet than it is here. But they'd get to singing those songs. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior. And if I could always tell. I could always tell because I'd start getting those doodads on my arm and I knew it was getting good. And I knew if I was sitting in front of my grandmother, I would just cringe because I knew in just a moment, in just a minute, she was going to go, woo! And then they'd be like, you want to go eat after church? Yeah, but I got to go change my clothes first. She could shout her out, honey. Was she perfect? No. But they defined who I am today. At 11:11 on Sunday morning, the week after Easter, I've got to ask you the question. What have you allowed to define you? Have you allowed an ex-spouse to define you? Have you allowed a sin to define you? Have you allowed a failure to define you? Again, going back to the text, it was doubting Thomas who gave his life for the Lord Jesus. And although we still tout him as being the doubter, we judge him on one brief moment in his history. And we fail. I hope that when we get to heaven, we can't see what's going on here. I don't want you to take this wrong. I don't want to see my wife get married again. And if something happened to me today, I know she'd get married again. She's a good-looking woman. They'd be on her like white on rice. I don't want to watch that. I don't want to watch my kids grow up and struggle with things in their life. And there will be struggles along their way. But I hope today that Thomas cannot peer down into this building and into this church and hear us call him doubting Thomas. One moment should not define who Thomas was. And it should not taint his memory, but we should celebrate what he did within the kingdom. I don't know how you have walked into this place. Maybe you've walked into this place looking in the mirror this morning thinking, I am fill in the blank. I am dirty. I am nasty. I am hooker. I am drug addict. I am alcoholic. I am failure. Regardless of how you walked in the place today, I have great news for you. Because you can leave here defined in the eyes of God differently than what you walked in here. That as you are now looking in the mirror and you are struggling with your own self-worth and your own identity, and they've called you names and they've called you zit face and they've called you fat and they've called you ugly and they've called you failure and they've called you dirty and they've called you stupid. It is irrelevant what they call you. What matters is you must allow the presence of the Lord to define who you are. That I am the head and not the tail. I am above and not beneath. I am not the sum of my past. I am who God says I am. I am important. I am holy. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. I am healed. I am saved. I am delivered. And I will not let let some turkey define who I am, but I will allow the Holy Spirit to define who I am, and I'll start hanging out with eagles because I am one. I'm not a turkey. I'm an eagle in Jesus' name. Stand to your feet in this place. Father,